Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. Thanks for checking it out if you're new. I am joined today by my friend Morgan.
Hello.
Those of you who have been following the channel know that we're pretty big Scream fans over here. We've seen all the movies. We took the road trip for Scream 6 to see it in the same room instead of in the rectangles you see us in right now. And so today we've got a bit of a different kind of video. Away from our usual Scream content, a lot of it has been focused on Scream 6 because that's the most recent release. And today, Scream 6 is available on digital formats and streaming on Paramount Plus. The movie's also been in theaters for a month, so we thought, what better time? You know, everybody's had time to avoid spoilers for as long as you can. And I would still say, don't watch this video. Obviously, clear spoilers. You know, from the thumbnail and
the
title.
Biggest spoilers, yeah.
That we're ranking the Ghostfaces. The Scream franchise is unique in that it doesn't have Ghostface comes back every time, but he's played by someone different. So, minus Roger L. Jackson, who arguably best Ghostface. And so Morgan and I are going to go back and forth, starting all the way down at the bottom, number 12, and just work our way up to our number one, see where our lists line up, where they differ.
Yeah.
All that fun.
I'm Morgan M. Steele. Like Connor said, I have a YouTube channel. He will link it somewhere. No, he won't. I make all kinds of videos, basically whatever I'm feeling week to week. Right now, we're in the middle of a series where Connor and I and a couple of our other friends get drunk and read stuff that I wrote when I was 15. So if you're interested in that, head over to my channel. I make movie content, writing content, book content, all sorts of stuff. But yeah. And I also like Scream.
Yeah.
So.
So starting out with my number 12, it was hard to pick a number 12, honestly, because the handful near the bottom I both love and hate. But ultimately my number 12, I went with Roman Bridger from Scream 3. Because he's not even in the movie, really. Like, part of me likes, like, it's the nostalgia, like, that's the trilogy. He caps off that trilogy of the original three, and, you know, the secret brother twist isn't great, but it's at least some kind of connection, but, yeah, he's just not in that movie enough, and... I mean, Sydney doesn't even know who he is when we get the Ghostface reveal.
Literally, yeah. Because I don't even remember if she spoke to him before that point, or if he was... I don't think they shared a screen.
No.
Up until the reveal. And we as the audience, like you said, like, we barely spend any time with him. We spend more time with all of the actors that are, like, in the... What is it called? The
Stab 3.
Stab, yeah, the Stab movies. We spend more time with that cast than we do with Roman at all. Like, so, I don't know. Just, yeah, no, I totally agree. He's pretty low on my list as well. My number 12 is fucking Detective Bailey, whatever his name is, Kirsch. Just because I'm sure he's great in other stuff. His performance as a Ghostface is a little stiff. Like, just his, you know, acting in general in that movie is a little stiff. And also, like, the reveal... I thought was very just, it fell flat for me. That was where the film just kind of fell on its face. And I was like, oh, okay. And overall, like we said in our like initial reactions to the film, I think it could have benefited from a bigger cast. Because, you know, there just weren't enough red herrings that I was like, oh, it could be this person. It could be that person. It was like, it's definitely the detective. Like, who else is it? And it just, you know, he just, yeah, not great for me.
Similar thoughts. Don't love Bailey. He's he's a little up, a little higher up, but not quite. My number 11, I don't think you'll be too shocked, is Charlie Walker from Scream 4. Oh, maybe you will be shocked. Charlie, very similar to Roman for me. A nothing of a character. He's... Okay. Like, and, you know, granted, that might also be because he gets overshadowed by Jill in that movie.
Yeah, so, big time.
Because, actually, you know, if you look at Yeah, Zach Cherry does the who killed who breakdown of like who physically could or could not have been in that scene.
Right. You
know, it is Charlie doing like all the kills in Scream 4, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's just he doesn't have the presence for me, and then he just he gets
and he's kind of like trying to fill that Randy spot, and it just like can't be filled. Mm-hmm. Other than Mindy, like I love Mindy is in the Randy slot, but.
He just gets that one step up from Roman for me because you can at least predict him. He's at least a character in the movie.
Yeah.
Versus, like we said, Roman has like three scenes. So when they do the Ghostface reveal, it's, I watched those movies with friend of the channel Phil with 1L. Yeah. And I had to turn to him. And, who?
Yeah, my number 11 is Roman. Like I said, he's also like very low on the list for all the reasons you said. He's barely in the film. He's a death fake out, which I do not love. I feel like if it were done better, it would be fine. But, you know, they find his body or fake body. I guess we don't know, whatever. And I was just like, oh, cool, he's dead. You know, and I just like didn't even give it a second thought. Like, I think the only thing I thought was because of the banner out front that says happy birthday, Roman. I was like, oh, on his birthday. But those are like my only thoughts towards him. Like, he's just such a nothing in the background character. And like you said, the sibling twist sucks. I feel like if they had dropped that in, not even as an ending twist, like, whoa, secret siblings, but like kind of in the middle of the movie, like, oh, Sydney's mom had a kid. And then we're trying to figure out who the kid is. Is it Angelina? Is it that other person? Like, trying to figure out, like, who? Yeah. Like, not even the gender of the person. I feel like it could have worked a little better, but the fact that they just drop it on us at the end, it's like, oh, okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Secret family we don't give a shit about.
Yeah, you're right. That it is. Because now I'm trying, it's been a while since I've watched Scream 3, but like you said, I can't remember if there are any kind of baby hints.
Because it's more about Sydney's mom and just, like, what she's doing. And it's like, okay, how is this related to her? But I feel like if we'd had, like, just a little, oh, she had a secret kid in Hollywood at some point, then it would have been stronger than, what's up with her mom? What did her mom do? You know? Because, I don't know. It just, meh.
Bringing it back to Scream 6, my number 10 is Quinn Bailey, or Quinn Kirsch. Similar as the other two, not enough screen time. I love her unhinged performance as once, you know, these movies do it all the time where everybody takes the mask off and now they're crazy. And I love her crazy, her unhinged. She embraces that, but again, not really in the movie. She's another fake out death. Rewatching Scream 3, it's a little obvious. It's like, okay, I can see how it was. He kills his own daughter. Like, it's set up. And we don't see the kill and everything. Yeah.
Yeah. My number 10 is also Quinn. And for that same reason, like, she's barely on screen. I like the fact that, like, they play into that trope of, oh, she's the slut, and then she ends up being the killer. Like, I like that, but I just wish we had more of her. I wish they had, like, killed her off a little later on, because, like, we lose her and Annika in one fell swoop, and then it's like, okay, then, like, who? Literally, who is left? So I feel like if they had kept her alive for a little bit longer, had her have, like, one more encounter with the others and Ghostface, like, I could have been like, okay, like, maybe she's a suspect, but they killed her too fast. And she just, you know, she doesn't get developed enough for it to be a twist when she shows up. I'm just like, whoa, she's not dead. Especially when there's three of them. Like, there's too many ghost faces and too few people left to, like, effectively rule anyone out. So.
I'm curious if this one will line up with my number 9 is Ethan Bailey or Kirsch, whatever you want to call him. again, like you said, suffers from the movie not having enough characters. Very clear, very obvious. I love that Mindy calls him out right at the start. And, like, that's where, on my second rewatch, it is fun. Because when you rewatch that scene, it's Ethan and Quinn are the two bouncing off Blame, and you know,
right,
they're the two ghost faces.
Mm-hmm.
So there's fun in the rewatch, but yeah, yeah, I was not a fan the first go, and again, similar to Quinn, I like Jack Champion's. I hope his name is Jack Champion.
I'm like 70% sure.
Yeah, I like his unhinged craziness. Yeah. He's weird. He gets stew-mackered.
He's very obvious, literally.
He's like you said, where there's not enough characters because they get killed off so fast.
Yeah.
And by, you know, middle of the movie, it's like, okay, Ethan hasn't been here for like three Ghostface attacks now.
Yeah. Yeah. Process of elimination. Very easy. Yeah, my next slot is Mrs. Loomis. Just because, again, like, she's like Roman. She's like kind of a nothing character. And I haven't seen Scream 2 in a while, so maybe there's more foreshadowing than I feel like. And they're smart. Like, they don't have Sydney on screen with her at all, because Sydney recognizes her and knows who she is. She's only ever with Gale. But it still was just like, I don't know. I like the twist that she is his mom. Like, I think that's crazy and fun. But in terms of her, like, as a character, like, I just feel like she's very... And someone, I think it was probably Zach Cherry, pointed out, like, Gale literally wrote a book about Billy. You'd think she'd, you know, do some research, see some pictures. And I know they're like, oh, she, like, lost a bunch of weight and, like, whatever. But, like, I don't know. It just, yeah, she's pretty low for me.
Yeah. a little higher up, but similar thoughts, similar feelings.
Yes.
Number eight, it's a little higher than yours, but it's Detective Bailey, Wayne Bailey, Wayne Kirsch, whatever you want to call him. For me, it's just kind of a, he has, honestly, I think it's more of a liking his ghost face more than him, which might not be fair, because, you know. Usually it's just a stunt actor or someone.
Right.
But, like, I like the idea of... part of the Scream 6 marketing was, this Ghostface is different, you know? We've never seen
him. He has a shotgun.
Yeah, like, the bodega scene is so cool. And that's him. Like, we know it can only be him. And I think he's so... Again, it's the end reveal. He's Hammond. Yeah. That actor is cheesing it up after the reveal. He's vibing. But not much to him. More interesting than his kids, but not by much for me.
Mm-hmm. Yes. My next slot is Ethan. Like, I have him higher than the other two just because, like, the subway bit got me, because he's on the subway with Mindy. He doesn't stab her. He doesn't kill her after. Like, I was like, oh, okay, maybe he's not. Like, he got me for a second, whereas the other two, I was like, oh, if it's the detective, it's definitely Quinn. And then, you know, Ethan was the wild card, because you don't know that they're related until the very end. So he's, you know, he's fun leading up to the Ghostface stuff. He's kind of fun after. I don't know. I'm not an Ethan girly. There's so many on TikTok. It pisses me off. They're like, he's misunderstood. Like, no, he was shaking that ladder under Annika. Like, there is no excuse for that. But yeah, he just, you know, he got me a little more than the other two did. I thought his twist was... at least a twist, like the other two, I totally expected. So,
and just like that, 3/4 of the Kirsch family are out of the running for number one. But
we are.
Yeah, could have been better. I like the idea of the family of ghost faces.
But yeah,
just
the execution.
My number 7 is Mickey Altieri from Scream 2. All right. I don't love Mickey, just because Mickey's whole thing is just kind of, he's crazy. I'm going to blame it on the movies. Yeah. Like, he's got no beef.
Yeah.
in this. Like, he's just Miss Loomis's puppet. He's just here literally. To be the killer and the fall guy. And so, that being said, oh my god, I'm blanking on the actor's name. He's in The Mandalorian. Timothy Oliphant.
Yeah.
That being said, Timothy Oliphant is hamming it. Like, his performance is great.
He's great.
He's fun to watch.
Yes.
But just not one of my... He's... Well, I say not one of my favorites. He's in the middle of the pack right there at number 7.
Yes. Hell yeah. My number 7, and I also know if you included Jason in your tier, the opening kill of Scream 6.
I didn't
think you would. So my number 7 is Amber. She was kind of predictable, definitely more predictable than Richie. I thought she had an awesome kill. Like, when she died getting lit on fire, holy shit. That's great. I think I would have liked her more if she and Tara had been girlfriends like they were supposed to be. Because I love the idea of both of the killers being the love interest. Like, that is so... Because, like, you would suspect one, but I don't think you would think it's both of them. You'd be like, okay, which of these love interests? And then it's both of them. Like, that would have been so cool. So I think if she was, she would be a little higher. I like her vibe. Like, I think she's fine. The fact that she lives in Stu's house and then, like, the zoom out to the front of the house, like... cinema, so good. Not that she, you know, picked where she lived, but just kind of middle of the pack. And then right above her I have Jason, just because it's such a twist that he takes the mask off in the fucking opening of the movie and then gets ghost-faced. So yeah, very very memorable in his fucking 5 minutes of screen time. So that I have him in there as a little bonus, just like right above Amber.
Fair enough. I might sound like a little
Jason.
Bit of...
His name is Jason. Oh my god. It's not Greg. Greg is the roommate.
I was questioning it, but I just figured she remembers.
Yeah. You're going to have to take the clip of me saying Jason and then dub over all the time. Greg. But that's how little screen time he has, is I didn't remember his fucking name. Anyway, Jason.
There you go.
Awesome opening kill and a ghost face. Bonus ghost face. Anyway.
Yeah, I might sound like a little bit of a hypocrite later on. Amber's a little higher up.
All right.
After I just said Mickey is nothing but a weapon to be pointed. But that's for later.
Yeah.
Because right now my number 6 is Nancy Loomis.
Okay.
I fully admit, there's some personal bias here with this then. Because... this was, like I said, Phil and I marathoned these. Marathoned the original 3, the trilogy. Uh-huh. I called Nancy from her first scene.
Really?
And she's like the only ghost face where I've called it like immediate. Mm-hmm. She's a ghost face. Because I was. I don't know what it was about her. It was just, she's too damn... She's too damn nosy. She keeps following Gale around. There ain't something right about her. She ghost face.
She ghost face.
But, yeah.
Props to you. Yeah, I never.
But she is. And I like the crazy killer of the mom. Mm-hmm. You know, the crazy mom killer. But, middle of the pack. She's not my favorite. But I like. I have that. Nostalgia, personal bias.
Yeah.
Enjoy her. She's a fun one.
Mm-hmm.
But like you said, a little weird that nobody, like, we know Scream 2 was rewritten to shit because they had leaks and
did
stuff.
Did it leak? Yeah. But, I thought so.
Yeah. So she does stink a little rewrites, but still a fun one.
Yeah. Yes. My number 6 is Charlie. And it is entirely because of the scene where he's tied to the chair and Kirby is playing the game and it's mirroring the opening of Scream 1. And I thought that was like so well done. And then it totally got me when he comes inside. She's so happy he's safe. And then he stabs her. It's only for that scene. Like, that sequence just is burned into my brain. And I, you know, I think his performance is fine. I like that they kind of twisted the Randy role into a ghost face. Because, like, I didn't suspect him because I was like, oh, he's a fucking nerd. Okay. Like, there's no way. Yeah, so. Charlie.
Yes. Yeah, I do like you said, the Randy.
Yeah.
Randy is the killer.
Mm-hmm. Just
wish he had been a little more.
Yeah, for sure.
Like you said, that scene, the whole phone call trivia game scene is mm-hmm. good.
Yeah. So good. Me love Kirby.
My number five, after just ragging on Mickey, is Amber Freeman.
Hey.
This one might be a little more of performance over writing. I love this actress and yeah, the unhinged great. That she is in the third act. And I feel like Amber is one of those where she gets better. I should preface this that, like, I love Scream 5. I've watched it.
Yeah, same.
Probably the most out of all the movies. And so, yeah, and it's just every time it gets better with rewatch. Amber and Richie are constantly deflecting. They cover things up. And it's just small things you notice. Like Amber stressing about this. You know, she gives Richie a awkward glance, which at the you know, initial watch you think it's because he's being weird. But then, you know, it's her, you know, like, shut the fuck up.
Right.
And then she is similar to Charlie, where if you kind of figure out who's where, she's got the body count of Scream.
Yep.
Five.
Yeah.
And yeah, I...
Yeah, because Richie is there a ton, so it has to be her.
Like, she's the one that takes out Dewey. Which, say what you will about logistics of that, but, you know, you always suspend that kind of suspension.
She's been working out. It's fine. She's, like... beefy.
Yeah.
She's been preparing for the role. Yes, my number five is Mickey. I love the unhinged third act. I like, he is kind of shady the whole movie. Like, upon rewatch I was like, yeah, absolutely. But his fake out with Derek, where he was like, it's Derek's the killer, it caught me the first time. I was like, because what if it is? What if it is because the last boyfriend was? Oh my god, Sydney! And then, you know, Derek dies, RIP. What a sweet boy. But yeah, he's great. I love that. Yeah, that sequence at the end where he's convincing her it's Derek, and he's like messing with her head, and like that's Ghostface. Just the but like you said, like, his motivation super weak. He's just like, I'm gonna be famous. Sure, in jail. Or worse. Like, this didn't end well for the last two guys that did that, right? You know that, right? Like, yeah, so.
Yeah, and I like what you just pointed out, how he does have the whole psychological thing. And I think it's interesting that we are, Mickey and Amber's, are inversed of each other. Because Amber tries to do the same thing of, you know, faking out, and Sydney and them call her out on her shit immediately.
Right. Right.
So, yeah, two interesting blunt weapons. My number four might be a little bit of a hot, maybe not the hottest take, who knows, Richie Kirsch. As someone who's a big Star Wars fan, I love Richie's motive of being just a fucking piss baby fanboy, because it's so accurate. He's such a fucking loser. And I'm gonna make a lot of people mad with this video. But yeah, and so I love Richie. Jack Quaid's performance, again, like I said before, with Amber, the more you rewatch it, the more little things you notice. Like in the Dewey hospital attack, Richie is freaking out in that scene.
Yeah.
And you know, you think it's because.
Right. He's,
Yeah, he doesn't want Sam, his girlfriend, or Dewey to get gutted by Ghostface when, like, really, he's probably. Dewey, please don't blow my girlfriend's brains out.
Right.
And so I Yeah, like I said, I love Richie's motivation. Just so timely and fits perfect.
Yes, no, I have him in the same spot. He's also my number four.
Hey.
He, for all those same reasons, I love his motivation. Like, we went to school with so fucking many of those tiny ass piss boy film boys. And it just, yeah. I, upon rewatch, you know, like he's watching all of the videos about stab and like the breakdowns and stuff. And you think it's because he's studying because he's like a stranger to all of this, but no, he's a fucking super fanboy, and that's the stuff he watches, like for fun. And he was pretty convincing. I was like, oh, it's not gonna be him. Like, especially in the party scene at the end when one of the extras says like, oh, someone's dad showed up. And he's like sending all the kids home. I was like, okay, yeah, like supportive boyfriend, no. the opposite of that, actually. And like you said, Jack Quaid's performance is fucking phenomenal. Chef's kiss. He's my favorite nepotism baby. the only valid one. But yeah, he's great. I really, really like him. And I like that the love interest is the killer as a callback to the first one. We'd love to see it.
Well, we're running out
Yeah.
of ghost faces.
Uh-oh. I have a lot of the same ones left, I would say.
I was gonna say, maybe these lists won't be as different as I thought. I think number one might be
Maybe.
different. But my number three is Billy Loomis, the
Huh?
original. And yeah, I like Billy a lot. He's cool. He's the brains of that operation. His the whole We all go a little mad sometimes. I got it on the poster right there. But yeah, no, I love his performance. Skeet Ulrich sells that, and the psychological torture Billy puts Sydney through with constantly bringing up her mom and like trying to seduce her and groom her. Like, yeah, Billy's just, yeah, he knows what he's doing, and with intent. He's just not number one because he's a little more serious than his partner.
Yes. My number three is Jill. I like the first time I watched Scream 4, I was influenced by the person I was watching the movie with. And he was like, oh, Scream 4 is garbage. Like, we only have to watch it for context. Me, 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 me. And I was like, okay, like literally one of the Richie fanboys. Literally one of the Richie fanboys. But you know, rewatching it with my mom, I like appreciated it a lot more. And also like the fucking twist of it being Jill. Because the whole time you think that they're setting her up to be the new Sydney. This is a reboot. Like she's gonna be the new Sydney. They're gonna make more movies with her and it's gonna be great. And you know, that script got scrapped and I really wish it didn't. But like, it's insane. And also when you factor in the fact that like she killed her mom or like had her mother killed for her own fame and glory and being the final girl of the story. And it's just like she's insane. And Emma Roberts is great at playing like that batshit crazy bitch. Like just so good at it. It's a perfect role for her. And yeah, it's crazy and such a fun subversion to like turn the Sydney into the Ghostface.
Well, maybe our list will line up more than I thought, because I thought Jill would be your number one.
Really?
Yeah, so Jill, you're number three. Jill's my number two.
The
Because yeah, like you said, Emma Roberts lives this up. I
wins.
love the twist of the Sydney being Ghostface. She was one of the ones I predicted, but not till like end game. Like, we paused the movie and Phil was, you know, all right, final Ghostface predictions. So, but yeah, I love her. The scene of her beating the shit out of herself and trashing the place,
It's
so
so good.
good. And now that I'm talking about this, I will give Charlie credit also that he does have the kill, the closet kill.
With the, holy shit.
Not to...
the most brutal kill in the series.
Yeah.
Like, when people are talking about, oh, Scream 6 is so gory, Scream 6 is so gory, like, they don't gut a girl and have her intestines on the bed. That is as gory as it has ever been.
Yeah.
Insane.
But yeah, with Jill, she's just unhinged. Like you said, Emma Roberts living it up. You brought up that she was supposed to, you know, in the original Scream 5 script, it was, you know, Sydney versus Jill again, you know, amnesia and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I do, like I said, obviously, if you've watched this video or you've watched my other videos, you know, big Scream 5 fan here.
Yes.
But I do want to see the universe where we got that continuation of Jill.
Yeah. Yeah. And I really wonder who the Ghostface would have been coming after her. Like, if it could have been Kirby, if she was still planned to survive. And now, like, now she's the Ghostface because she knows that Jill did it. Or, like... like, who, what random person would, like, pick up this story thread and be like, I know what you did.
Like, yeah,
like I want it so bad.
Like, Ghostface be Ghostface.
Yeah.
Morgan.
Yes. Oh, my number two. Yes. My number two is Billy. Like you said, he's fucking great. Like, you kind of can't beat the originals. He is calculated. He knows what he's doing. He's evil. Like, he was just gonna fucking gut Stu. Just like, I'm losing a lot of blood, man. Like, holy shit. I love the twist of, you know, the love interest being the killer. And even though he's, like, foreshadowed very early on to be the killer. Like, they're always, Randy's like, it's you. Like, blah, blah, blah. You're so fucked up. Like, whatever. And then, like, he literally goes to jail and gets questioned. And then, you know, more killings happen. And he's off the hook because he was in jail when they happened. So it couldn't have been him. And, you know, that movie was the first one where it's like, oh, there's two killers. That's the twist. Like, it's not one person. And, yeah, I just, his performance is amazing. Very iconic. Skeet's a great dude. Like, just, yeah, really, really love him.
Yeah. Well, who could have seen this? Maybe I should have seen this coming. But
yeah.
Oh, well, it looks like my number one is Stu Mocker. And, well, what's there to say that hasn't been said before? Matthew Lillard eats this role up.
Yes.
Stu is the fun one of the two. Like, I know Billy is the brains, but then Stu is the muscle with the hulking figure that Matthew Lillard is. And then he is just hamming it up. He loves that role. And, like, but he's not so stupid. Like, he does still have...
right.
The manipulation, like when he comes out after killing Tatum and, you know, he's trying to pin it on Randy, you know, oh, my poor Tatum, you know, like that's all so good. Everything after the killer reveal, like you said, the blood and his phone, him on the phone with Sydney, you know, my mom's
gonna be so bad.
So good.
Yeah. Yeah. Same, twinsies. we are the Matthew Lillard generation. Like, we grew up on Scooby-Doo and then finally became old enough to watch Scream. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I love him so much. His performance is fucking incredible. Just, like, the whole thing, because, oh my god, what's her name? Casey? At the beginning? Yes?
Yes.
Opening kill? Yes. Okay. She's his ex-girlfriend. And so the fact that, like, they kill his ex-girlfriend and her boyfriend, and then, like, he kills his girlfriend again. He kills Tatum in the iconic garage scene. Like, it's insane. Like, watching it back, you know, seeing him, like, interact with Tatum and, like, they're being all cuddly and stuff. And he almost spoils it, like, several times. And Billy's like, dude, shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
Like, just his kind of his recklessness about, like, I was somewhere, like, during the, you know, like, he's so good. And especially at the end, like, is crying and is, I'm losing a lot of blood, man. Like, it's not going the way he thought it would go. And yeah, Matthew sells it. He's amazing. He's an icon. I'm so glad he's coming back into the, you know, the public eye with the FNAF movie coming up. And just a legend. Love him so much. And then, of course, he has, like, the coolest kill with the TV.
And then with, you know, obviously this, none of it's canon or whatnot, but the whole another scrapped scream idea. Yeah, the cult of Stu surviving. Normally I hate retcons like that of, you know, oh yeah, he survived. But I think the Scream franchise,
like, he got shot in the head, you know.
I think the Scream franchise has reached a point where you know, okay, yeah, I can believe. I believe he's alive.
Yeah.
I know it might be jumping the shark, but screw it.
I don't care. Bring him back.
At this point, we 7 movies in.
Yeah. Gotta jump the shark at some point. Bound to happen. Yeah. No, I love him. I hope they would do it in a you know, a way that makes sense and is not too, like, cheesy, but I would like to see him come back, because, you know, Skeet gets to come back in the hallucination sequences, and I think it would be cool for Matthew to come back as well.
Yeah,
get that love from the fan base. Not that he doesn't already, but, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, I loved the Scream 6 opening, like, so much. Tony Revolori, love that man. Honorary Ghostface.
Honorable mention from me. Morgan put him on her list.
Yeah, it was in the Tear Maker template that I was using. He was in there. Some of them had Greg in there, too, the one that gets chopped up in the fridge. It's like, what did he do other than die off screen before the movie started? Yeah. He's in the fridge. Yes, but his name is Jason, not Greg, and I said it was Greg the whole time, and it's fine. I have ADHD.
It's okay. I would have just called him Tony Revolori.
Tony Revolori. I love that man. He's so good. Yeah.
Thank you all so much for watching our ranking of the ghost faces. Let us know down below your ranking of the 12 ghost faces we've seen over this franchise. If you liked what you saw here, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell so you know when that next one's coming. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.